All right. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Hi, kids. How are you? Good to see you. All right. Well, Father, we just ask for just your presence, Lord, in our midst. Oh, Lord, for you to lead us, Lord, and guide us. And, oh, Lord, we thank you for, Lord, just your faithfulness and your many blessings, Lord. Oh, Lord, we rely upon your Holy Spirit to lead us and to guide us, to speak to us. And Lord, we trust, Lord, in your ability to lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. So, Lord, bless everything that we say and do today, Lord, that it might bring glory and honor to your name. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your breath come from heaven, fill our hearts with your life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let our shout be your anthem. Your renown fill the skies. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead come to life. We are here for you. We are here for you. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down.
Let's sing that again.
To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. We welcome you with praise, we welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, we welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise, we welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Let every heart adore, let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise, we welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcome in this place. Hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast at the table. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. Come all you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy and his burden light. Able, you will restore at the There is peace at the table of the Lord. Do you believe that this morning? There is peace at the table of the Lord. I won't worry anymore at His table. There is healing at the table of the Lord. There is healing at the table of the Lord. I won't suffer anymore at His table. Come all you weary, come and find His yoke is easy and His burden light. He is a at the table of the Lord. I know He has a place for me. What joy would fill my heart. The saints around the mercy seat of all you weary, come and find His yoke is easy and His burden light. He is able, He will restore at the table of the Lord. Yeah, at the table of the Lord. I'm invited to the table of the Lord. I'm invited to the table of the Lord. He says, come just as you are to His table. Come all ye weary, come and find His yoke is easy and His burden light. He is able, He will restore at the table of the Lord. There is room at the table of the Lord. Won't you come and sit at the table with the Lord. Yeah, what a day that's going to be, huh? He's sitting at the wedding supper of the Lamb. My soul, it sings out as Your word throws doubt far away. I sing to You and my heart cries, holy, hallelujah, for You are near. My hope is in You, Lord, all the day long. That passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in You alone. my selfishness and show me grace. I worship you, my heart cries glory, hallelujah, Father, you are here. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. Storm, peace that passes understanding is my song. My hope is in you. I will wait on you. You are my Lord, we do. We put our hope and our trust and our reliance in you, Lord, for there is no surer foundation than that which is laid in Christ Jesus. Lord, when we look at our lives, Lord, especially in these days in which we live, Lord, we need a firm foundation. We need to know that we're on solid footing. And so, Lord, we want to stand, Lord, not in our power and might, but in the power and the might of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we need to be underpinned, Lord, with your word, God, as it gives us stability to know that you speak to the days and the times and the seasons. And Lord, you have a message for us today, Lord, that comes from your word. And so, Lord, we ask your anointing and your blessing upon the teaching of your word. We ask it in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen, amen. So why don't you all stand just for a moment, and you can't hug, now you can't shake hands, but you can stand, and you can turn around and say hi to someone and welcome one another. You can do that real quick. All right, everybody. Isn't it great just to to be able to fellowship with a live person. Good morning. Good morning, Miss Martha. Good to see you. All right. All right. Well, we're in Revelation chapter 6. And in order to understand what's going to happen from this point on, because in Revelation chapter 6, what we begin to see is the judgment that's going to be poured out upon the earth. Now, the question that arises is, you know, where is the church? What's happened with the church? Is the church still on the earth? Has the church been raptured? So there are varying teachings on the rapture. There are those that are pre-trib. In other words, before the tribulation, the church is going to be raptured out. There's mid-trib. There are those who say it won't happen until 3.5 years in, where we have the abomination of desolation, where the Antichrist reveals really what he's all about and what he's up to. And he establishes himself on the throne there in the rebuilt temple. And then there are those that believe that the church is going to go through the tribulation. And if you believe that and you want to go through the tribulation, I'll be praying for you, because I'm pre-trib and I'll be in heaven. I'll be with the Lord. But regardless of really the tribulational views, the millennial views, what that's going to look like, what the millennial kingdom is going to look like, one of the things that it's important to understand, are we seeing days leading up to the return of Christ? Are we in those days? Is that what we're dealing with right now? You know, what is the world coming to? I mean, I hear that constantly. Is Armageddon around the corner? Is the return of Christ at the door? Can we know the future? Now, we don't know the imminent return of the Lord, but we are told to look up, for our redemption is closer today than it was yesterday. And we're told to look for the signs that we see going on around us. And we're getting a lot of those signs right now. I mean, we're seeing a lot of chaos and a lot of rebellion. And some would say, well, it's warranted. And others would say it's not warranted. And then you have people that are in between and saying, well, there does need to be change and there needs to be justice. And you need to understand something. The best change that can happen in your life and in my life is the change that the Lord brings, the changes that He wants to make in me. Because wherever I may be in my worldly philosophy and my personal living, the transformation of Jesus Christ is what makes me a new creation. It transforms me. And in that transformation, it will change the way that I think. It'll change my attitude. It'll change even how I see other people. And that is the work of the cross. That is the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. Some of the questions that people are asking, I mean, I'm getting these emails and they're saying, well, we're just seeing the deterioration of society around us. There is a great uncertainty with so many people. And I even got some emails yesterday and folks wondering if it's safe to come back to church. In spite of the breathtaking advances that we see with science and especially with technology, and we have the benefit of that this morning because we're able to live stream to the whole world right now. You guys didn't know you're going out in the airwaves. But we've only seen the condition of man seemingly get worse, and nation warring against nation. So in these anxious and critical days, some look to politicians. Others are looking to a world leader. Is there maybe one world leader, someone that's going to stand up and give direction to the whole planet? Well, the Word of God tells us that there will be such a person in the last days. It will be the Antichrist. And he will come in and he will bring peace and safety, and wars will end, and there will be a one world religion. There will be a one world government, a one world economic system. We know that that's going to happen because the Word of God predicts it. But others are turning to psychics. I noticed that the fortune telling or psychic channel on TV, I see those advertisements a lot more now than I did before the pandemic. Or the latest movement that somehow is going to promise change and sometimes at any cost. Yet all the while there has been someone who knows exactly what the future holds, and we know his name. His name is Jesus. And he's the one that's revealed in the Word of God. And so it's important to understand that as we go forward with the book of Revelation, and especially as we get in chapter 6, and we're not going to be looking at all of those elements this morning, but this is a precursor to chapter 6. And it's important that we understand that we have to have a prophetic standard. Now, the Word of God has prophecy in it. It is a prophetic book. The Bible is the only book that dares to predict the future. It is worth noting that two-thirds of the Bible is prophecy. One half of these prophecies have already come to pass. You can go back into the Old Testament and even in the New Testament and prophecies that were made about the coming of the Messiah, about Jesus' crucifixion, about his resurrection. Those things have already happened. No other world religions have books that do this, that can predict the future and look at the past with such accuracy. If they did it, it would be evident they were not inspired by God as the Bible is. The basic test of the true God, the true faith, the true prophet, and the true belief is this. Can they predict the future? Is there some way of me knowing exactly what the future holds? My phone's talking to me. So I'll call you later. You get phone calls back from the Midwest and guys on the East Coast. They've already had church. They've already had lunch, you know. In one half of the Bible, prophecies have happened just as God said that they would. Should I have any questions or any doubt that the remaining ones that are yet to come are going to pan out exactly the way that God said that they would? God can speak of the future with absolute certainty because he's the one who holds the future in his hands. He's outside of time and space, so nothing is happening without the knowledge of God or the accepted will of God, God allowing things to happen. And you say, well, what about all the chaos and what about all of the devastation and the murders, the killings and all? Those things are happening not outside of the preview of God. They're being allowed because God has given men a will to do that which they will to do or to do the will of God. And so those things are going to happen. We live in a fallen world. So the signs of the times, that's a good question to be asking. We are living at a time when Bible prophecy is being fulfilled before our very eyes. We have all watched the dramatic changes that have taken place in all the major centers of power around the world. Just look what's happened in the last 10 years. Look what's happened in Israel with the moving of the U.S. Embassy to Jerusalem. Look what's happened in the Middle East with the ISIS war, with the Syrian war. Look what's going on right now in North Korea. I mean, if you look at all of these things, you see that there's been some dramatic changes. We've seen the emergence of China as a major economic power, while the United States has been fading in its prominence. We see the increasing isolation of the nation of Israel in the rising hostility of nations, and not just Middle Eastern nations, but nations around the world. Anti-Semitism is greater now than it's ever been, going all the way back to the Nazi regime. These are signs that Jesus said would tell us that his time is near. In Mark 13:29, it says, "So you also, when you see these things happening, know that it is near at the very doors." Now, I wouldn't have a problem if the Lord comes today. I mean, it'd be what a blessing to have lunch in heaven, you know? And yet, we know not the day nor the hour, so there is this need for preparedness. The Bible also predicts the behavior and the mood of the people just prior to his return. Jesus told us that in the last days preceding his return would be like the days of Noah and also the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. In Luke 17, verses 26 through 29, And as it was in the days of Noah, so it will also be in the days of the Son of Man. They ate, they drank, they married wives. They were given in marriage until that day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Those aren't my words. Those are the words of Jesus. Jesus says, you just need to understand that there will be righteous judgment. Things will not go without the judging hand of God. And yet in the midst of it, some would say, well, why doesn't God do something? Well, he is doing something and he wants to do something. And what he wants to do is he wants people to get saved. He wants to give more grace and more opportunity for people to turn their hearts away from their sinful, carnal, fleshly desires and turn their hearts over to God. So God is being merciful to us, even in the midst of all of the chaos. I mean, you can ask the question, what are some of the signs of the last days? Well, before we get into it, let's take a moment and let's look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Notice down in verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. And I love what Paul writes to the church at Thessalonica. You know, he established that church, but he was only there for a few weeks. But notice what he says. But I do not want you to be ignorant. In other words, he says, I don't want you to be without understanding. I want to bring some clarity so that you understand and you comprehend what it's going to be like in those last days. He says, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. So he says, people that have already died, he says, I want you to know and not be ignorant of where they're at. He says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, if you believe that this morning, say amen. All right. He says, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. Bring with him. So evidently what Paul is describing for them is when Jesus returns. He says, for this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. I believe that what Paul was doing, he was describing the rapture of the church. And so prior to the tribulation, those judgments that we begin to see taking place in Revelation chapter 6, the church is going to be raptured out. Notice on in chapter 5, read a little bit further. He says, but concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. Why would he say that? Well, because he said all you have to do is just look around at what's going on. Just look at where things are at, how things are unfolding, things that are taking place. He says, for yourselves know perfectly like the day of the Lord comes as a thief in the night. So we don't know the day nor the hour, but it will happen. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness. Now, there we wouldn't say amen, but we would say hallelujah. You know, praise God. I'm not in darkness. I'm in the light. And I walk in the light of the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, so that this day should not overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. He says, we are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. So there needs to be a watchfulness. We need to be aware not only of what's going on around us socially and politically and governmentally and globally. There's nothing wrong with being informed and staying informed, but are we staying informed biblically? Are we spending enough time in the Word of God to understand that we can begin to see the genuine indicators, the markers of the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what are some of the signs? What is it that we would be looking for? Well, the Word of God's clear. And a lot of this is not new stuff. A lot of this has been going on since the fall of man. Sexual promiscuity and perversion. Nowhere is this better seen than in Lot's visit with two angelic visitors in the city of Sodom. They're in Genesis chapter 19. Read that story. Genesis 19, verses 1 through 17. There the visitors found all manner of sexual perversion, homosexual activities of the day coming to Lot's door. Likewise, today's popular culture is celebrating promiscuity and perversion while it mocks the God-given principles for purity and for marriage and for a relationship between a man and a woman. This is where we're at. There will be increased violence and crime. Noah's time was characterized by an exceedingly wicked violence and crime. In Genesis chapter 6, and you read the story of the flood, it says, "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only to do what? Only evil." And how often? It says continually. "The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence." And so what was God's remedy? He takes out a remnant. He takes Noah and his wife and his sons and their wives, and he separates them out. It was a remnant to preserve the race. And then he destroys the earth with a great flood. Does this not sound like a description of some of the things that we see every day? Wars erupt regularly around our planet. Genocide is taking place in several African countries as we speak. We also have our own problems in this country. And they're genuine problems. And they're problems that need to be resolved and need to be dialogued and talked about and need to be remedied. I'd be the first one to say that. But not at the expense of the destruction of our history and the destruction of a nation. George Magazine, maybe you probably remember that magazine. John Kennedy was the one who started it, but they ran an article in the 90s entitled, "Why Kids Are Ruining America." Why Kids Are Ruining America. Among other things, the reporter said this, "We are facing a potential bloodbath of teenage violence in the years ahead that will be so bad we will look back at the 1990s and say those were the good old days." Have you ever used that phrase? "Those were the good old days." Yeah, see, I can go all the way back to the 50s, you know, and say that. The article went on to state that teenagers have higher rates for violent crime than any other age group. This was written in the 90s. And yet the prediction was that it's going to get worse. A generation, thirdly, that will not see death. According to the Bible, there is a generation that will not see death. Instead, they will be removed from the face of the earth in what is known as the rapture of the church. 1 Corinthians 15, that whole chapter is about the resurrected life and the transformed life. Paul said this, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." That's what was described also there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the verses that we just read. The passage contains the most definitive verses on this subject. Let's take a moment and let's just kind of break this down, this whole idea of the church being removed. Notice what it says, going back to 1 Corinthians, or 1 Thessalonians. I got 1 Corinthians and 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. Notice what it says. "And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together." We will be caught up. So what is the idea here? Scripture speaks of this event in other passages as well. In Matthew 24, Jesus giving one of his last messages, he says, two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. So it's going to happen instantaneously. There won't be any forewarning. In John 14, 24, Jesus said, in my Father's house, he said, there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going there. He says, I'm preparing a place. So from the point of Jesus' resurrection and ascension to the Father, he has been making preparations for us. Preparations in heaven. And he says, and if I go and prepare a place for you, he says, I'm going to come back and take you with me, that you can be where I am. He says, so I'm going to come and get you. I remember a number of years ago, I was just a little guy. I know you look at me this morning, that's hard to believe, but I was a kid once. And word had come, a phone call had come, that my uncle was going to be coming into town, and that he wanted to come by and he wanted to pick me up. And he wanted to spend the day with me. And I remember I was so excited, because whenever Uncle Russ would do that, he would always take me to really cool places. He'd take me to wrestling down in Los Angeles at the old auditorium down there, and go watch the wrestling, or take me to boxing matches. Or my favorite place was, he used to take me to the racetrack with him. And he'd go bet on the horses, and of course I didn't know anything about that, but I just loved seeing the horses, and so I was waiting in anticipation. Well, what happened was, as I was waiting and I was thinking, well, he should be here by now, and what's taking so long? And what had happened was, his car had broke down and he never showed up. But early the next morning there was a knock on the door, and it was him. And my mom answered the door, and he explained what had happened, and he said, I'm sorry. He said, I was going to call, but he said, I was trying to get things taken care of. But I remember he came in the bedroom, and I was still asleep, and he leaned over, and he shook me, and he said, Johnny, he said, I'm here. He said, you got to get up. We got to get going. You see, I thought I knew when he was going to be there, but he eventually did come and get me. And it's so with the Lord. In 1 John 3, John says, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has yet to be made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be just like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. And that last part of 1 John 3, that third verse, is important. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself. In other words, there's an understanding the Lord could come at any time, and so I need to be working on my spirituality. I need to make sure that my life is in order with God. I need to be walking in righteousness and holiness and godliness and dealing with anything in my life that's not pleasing to the Lord. And I know that's an everyday process, right? Every day. You know, we're going through that refining process. The Holy Spirit shows us something or convicts us of something. And God's saying, okay, let's work on that now. Let's deal with that. Let's see if we can get that out of your life and bring about a little bit more godliness and a little bit more holiness and a little bit more purity. And I use that word holy because it's a powerful word. It means being set apart to God. And if I'm set apart to God, there's going to be less of the world in me and there's going to be more of God in me. Does that make sense? Second thing that he said there in verse 17 is, we will meet the Lord. The Greek word for meet carries the idea of meeting a royal person or a person of great magnitude and significant importance. That is because when the Lord calls us to himself, we're going to meet the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We will see him as the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. We're going to stand face to face with Jesus. We're going to converse with him. Think about that. So it's important to understand that this transformation, this powerful transformation, is important. Some of the effects of the rapture are borne out in the Word of God. The rapture means no death. I know that as I get older, that there's more of a possibility that I can pass away. I could die. I would rather that the Lord come and rapture us. I would prefer that, just to be here and then instantaneously in His presence. Now, if death comes, I already have the promise that the dead in Christ shall be raised first. So if I die, my spirit is with the Lord, but then there's going to be a physical body at the rapture. As I said earlier, there is a generation that's not going to see death. Are we that generation? Are things lining up? And when I was younger, when I first came to the Lord, to be quite honest with you, I would hear a lot of teaching, because in the 60s and 70s, there was a lot of emphasis on the return of the Lord. Calvary Chapels teach pretty extensively on the second coming and on the rapture of the church and on end times prophecy. But to be quite honest with you, I remember sitting in church one Sunday and my pastor was teaching on the rapture of the church, and he was very excited. He was very animated, and he would get very loud, and it was very dramatic. And I remember sitting there, and the first thought that popped into my head was, man, I'm in my 20s. Lord, just hold off and let me live for a little bit. You know, there's some things that I want to do, some things that I'd like to accomplish. And you know what? I've got babies at home, and you know, so the mindset was this. I was clinging too much to the world rather than clinging to the cross. I was thinking too much about what I wanted to accomplish, what I wanted to achieve, what plans I had, rather than simply just relying and trusting that the plans that God has for me is far better and greater and richer than anything you will have ever experienced here. I remember a Christian artist, one of the first Christian contemporary artists, Keith Green. He was interviewed because in a lot of his music it was talking about the return of the Lord. And if you went to his concerts, he always used to give you a bumper sticker that said Maranatha, you know, Lord come quickly. And you'd see those bumper stickers everywhere. But he was asked that question about, you know, the rapture of the church. And he said, man, he said, let me just tell you. He said, this place, this world, he says, it's a trash bin in comparison to what we're going to have in heaven. He said, haven't you read the Bible? He said, the Lord has prepared a place for us. And he said, there are mansions. He said, the streets are paved with gold. He said, there's an emerald sea. And he said, we'll see the throne of God and the glory of God. And he said, man, he goes, we could never replicate that here. And he said, so, yeah, Maranatha, man. Lord, come quickly. Now, some would say, well, that's an escapist mentality. Not really. It's not escaping, but it's standing in the promise that's already been given and looking forward to that. I don't know exactly what heaven's going to be like, but I do know this. We're not going to be playing our harps and fluttering around in heaven. The Word of God says that we're going to be busy. There are going to be things to do. You know, maybe we'll be tending the eternal gardens in the new earth. But to know and understand that this is a transformation. When does the transformation begin? Well, the transformation, the eternal transformation, begins when you get saved. when you prayed and you said, Jesus, come into my heart, God says, okay, now I'm going to transform you. I'm going to make you into a new creation. And it'll be a process, and it'll take your whole lifetime as long as you draw back. And I'm going to be constantly working on you. I'm going to be refining you. I remember when I was in high school, I took wood shop. In the 60s, I think everybody took wood shop. But I remember I was working on a project on a little box, and I thought I was done with it. And the teacher, and I still see his face, Mr. Hurley, he came and he said, you know, Johnny, he said you need to work on that a little bit more. And he started pointing things out. And he said, you know, you got those edges are pretty rough, and you could sand those. And he said, you know, you're gonna wanna stain this. And he said, you know what? He said, you need to use a finer grit of sandpaper. He said, maybe like a 320 or a 400. Any of you who've ever done any sanding know what I'm talking about. Those of you who've never done any sanding, it doesn't mean anything to you. But then he said, just smooth it out and you can do more. And he said, you know, the outside, he said, it's looking pretty good. But he said, look at the inside. He said, somebody's going to open it up. And the point that stuck with me through that whole process was, that's what God is doing with us. Sometimes we think, man, I'm looking pretty good as a Christian on the outside. You know, I'm doing better. I'm not doing some of the things that I used to do. But God looks and he said, yeah, but you know, we need to get that 320 spiritual sandpaper on you, because you've got some rough edges. You got some sharp corners. But more importantly, let's open up your life. Let's look on the inside. You see, there's a lot that you see and know about me from the outside, but you don't know the inside. And I would never want you to know everything that's inside of me. And it's not that I'm hiding anything, but it's the struggles that we all deal with day in and day out in our lives. God doing a transforming work within us. That's why Paul said, we shall be changed in a moment. The word change is from the Greek word transformed. God will give us a brand new existence. Philippians 3, 20 and 21. For our citizenship, when you prayed and you said, Jesus, come into my heart, come into my life, your citizenship now is in heaven. It's in heaven. I know I went to the DMV right before the shutdown with the quarantine, and I got the new driver's license, the one that you have to have, and I went through that whole process, and I had renewed my passport. And I remember thinking about that here not too long ago and realizing that there is an identification that is not something that I carry in my wallet or in a passport. There is a spiritual identification. In other words, something that's inside of me, something that God placed inside of me when I got saved, when he put a seal upon my life. He sealed me with the Holy Spirit of promise. And he said, now, John, you are a citizen of heaven. That's where your citizenship is. And he says, you should eagerly wait for the Savior and the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. So my body is going to go through a transformation just as yours will. According, he says, to the working which he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. So the bottom line is this. When we think in terms of the church being in the presence of the Lord, it means no more death. It means a completed transformation, but also it's instantaneous. It's not something that's going to happen over a long period of time. Because in 1 Corinthians 15, he says that it's in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. It's been said that the twinkling of an eye is about 1,000th of a second. In other words, it's the time for light simply to refract off of the eye. That's how quick. It's from the Greek word atomos, from which we get the word atom. It means something that cannot be divided. In other words, the rapture will occur so quickly and suddenly, the time frame in which it appears cannot be humanly divided. It will happen so quickly, we will have no means of measuring that. And the reason being is because it's the work of an almighty and a supernatural God. If he exists outside of time and space, then that means he controls everything within time and space. A couple of more things. It's going to be a reunion. The question is often asked, will we see our loved ones? The Apostle Paul wrote these words to reassure the Thessalonians who had believing loved ones who had already died. They were afraid that their departed loved ones would be in some other part of God's plan, someplace else. They were afraid that they would never see them again. Paul's words had to have been extremely comforting, as they should be to us today. He says that the dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who remain will be caught up. We will be reunited with our departed believing friends and family and loved ones. We will be reunited with those we have led to Christ, people that we've been able to share with that have received the Lord. We're going to be reunited with them. We're probably going to recognize our loved ones in heaven. Paul told the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 13:12, he says, while we're here, he says, we just know just a little bit. We know in part, but then we shall know just also as I am known. One of the things that's so powerful when we think in terms of what God has in store for us is that even though as difficult as things may be, as crazy as things are around us, and trust me, they're going to continue. People say, well, things are going to get better, they're going to get better. The Word of God tells us something different. The world that we live in is going to continue to decline. And it has to do that in order to set the stage for the Antichrist and for the one world government, one world religion, one world monetary system. But here's the encouraging thing for you this morning. And this is important. I don't want you to miss this, because it could seem like a lot of doom and gloom. Though the world around us is going to continue to decline, the church doesn't. The children of God don't. Because we arise through the transforming work of Jesus Christ, who has saved us, and the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. Why is it that Christians throughout the generations, even when they were heavily persecuted, the church still remains? The Word of God still remains. The Bible is still the best-selling book year after year after year. It's because of the resilience that we have through Christ Jesus and standing upon the Word of God. Even the Apostle Paul said, nothing, not height, nor depth, nor width, nor breadth, nothing is going to separate me from the love of God. So that means there has to be, for all of us as believers, as the church, there has to be a godly determination within us. There has to be a resilience. There has to be a resistance to push back against that which is evil, that which is ungodly, that which is worldly, and never be ashamed to stand up and to say, yes, peace and safety in Christ Jesus. And all lives matter to God, for He desires that none perish and all would come to everlasting life. There in chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians, in verse 5, He says, you are all sons of light and sons of the day. You are not of the night nor of darkness. And then He says, therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch, let us be sober. In other words, know what's going on. Be aware of what's going on in the world. It's not a time for the church to be silent and for Christians to be quiet. Not at all. But he says, as you do that, be sober. Some people say that Christians live with their heads in the clouds, that we're not realists. In fact, the opposite is true. The person who believes that we, as one global family, can live together in peace and that man is basically good is not dealing with reality. Just turn on your TV tonight. Christians are the most sane people around because they are realistic about the problems, but more importantly, we want to not just focus on the problems, but we want to focus on the solutions. And the solution has always been the same. It's been Jesus. He says, Paul tells the Thessalonians, don't be asleep. We must not be sleeping, but we must be alert and ready. This same thought is reinforced in Romans 13:11. And do this, understanding, he says, the present time, the hour has come for you to awake from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Every click of the clock, every second, every minute, every hour, every day, every week, every month, every year, salvation is nearer than when we first believed. I like how J.B. Phillips, in his translation, phrases the next few lines there in Romans. He says, the night is nearly over, the day is almost dawn. Let us therefore fling away the things that men do in the dark. Let us arm ourselves for the fight of the day. Let us live cleanly as in the daylight, not in the delights of getting drunk or playing with sex, nor quarreling or jealousy. Let us be Christ's men from the head to the foot and give not chances to the flesh to have its carnal flings. A spiritual alarm had been sounded by the Apostle Paul on a number of occasions. In a sense, that is God's wake-up call for the church. Keep in mind that these words are addressed to believers. We have to be awake. We have to come out of spiritual lethargy and laziness and apathy to meet the urgency of the hour. Many of you know that I'm part of Calvary Disaster Relief, and right now I'm in the process of getting credentialed through Calvary Disaster Relief. And one of the things that I've seen through that process is that it takes preparation, and it's a process that gives me the ability to be able to go into a disaster area when it happens and to be there with the first responders. But there is a process that you have to go through. There are certain credentials that you have to have. And even one of those credentials is that I'm looking into is getting a credential, a press credential. Because when you look at things that are going on, and if you go to CalvaryDisasterRelief.org, if you go to the website, one of the things that we're expanding and we're looking at now is and understanding is that disaster isn't just always natural disaster. There are human disasters. There's emotional disaster. There's spiritual disaster. And what we're discovering is that we need to, as an organization, we need to be able to address that. But as we're expanding that, and as I'm looking at that and putting things in place, what I'm realizing is it's the exact same things that we want to do as an organization that God tells us to do as the church, and more importantly, that He tells us to do as individuals. And that is to come out from a laziness and lethargy and apathy and be there to meet the urgency of the hour. Jesus explained all of this to His disciples. In John chapter 9, verses 4 and 5, He says, I must work the works of Him who sent Me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. But I must work the works of Him who sent me. And I would echo that this morning. I must do the work and the works of Him who saved me and changed me. I believe, and I'm not a prophet, because if I claim to be a prophet and I make a prophecy and it has come true, you'd take me out in the parking lot and stone me. But I believe our time is limited. We must be doing the work of the Lord while we can. The last days, to those believers, Jesus said this, "See, I have set before you an open door and no one can shut it." No one can shut it. But there might be some dead weight that is slowing us down or dulling our desire to go through that door. It is time. Just like Paul told young Timothy, he says, it's time to prepare to meet your God. Are we ready? Love His appearing. That's what we're told to do. Love the appearing of Jesus. But until that happens, let us be busy about the Lord's business. Let's stand and pray. Father, we thank You, Lord, for You are good and You are gracious and You are awesome and You're powerful. And Lord, You're clear, Lord, what lays ahead for us. Lord, we do not cower in fear. Lord, we do not slumber or sleep. Lord, hopefully through the message today, Lord, it has aroused our spiritual senses, Lord. It's gotten deep into the recesses of our heart and challenged us to remember that the work is not done. We're not quarantined spiritually. We're not being stopped from speaking words of truth and words of life and words of grace and words of forgiveness. So, Lord, let us be that voice. Lord, that clear voice in these last days. For we pray and we trust and we believe and we rely upon Your grace, Jesus. We do all of that in Your holy and precious name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you and the Lord be with you all. Thanks for being here today. Get the word out. Let people know, man, we're having church. We are the church, and we're going to have church, even though you all look like bandits. We're going to have church. God bless you.